Good evening, Gauri ma'am. Thank you so much for being on my show. It's such an honor to have you, and I would request you to extend a few words.
Thank you for having me, Achal. You're doing a fantastic job by bringing together so much cooperation and knowledge among so many people. So I'd be happy to share some of my thoughts with you today.
Thank you so much, ma'am. To begin with, ma'am, I would initially want you to tell us something about People for Animals and how does it exactly function? And ma'am, what instance or what experience really inspired you to get on to becoming an animal rights activist?
People for Animals was started by Mrs. Menaka Gandhi in 1994. That's when basically she thought that there has to be a grouping together of people who want to rescue animals so that they're able to reach out to even more animals in need. They can open shelters, they can make volunteer groups. That was the idea behind making People for Animals. I think around that time, out of school, I also wanted to do something a little more meaningful in life, and I stumbled upon various social activities, but finally settled on working for animals because I thought that they are the most defenseless section of our society, that they are the citizens who are still most exploited. They don't even have the right to vote and they don't have a voice, and we kill them, we eat them up, we use them in laboratories, we use them in performances, we abuse them, and they are the ones who can't even complain. So I thought that being their voice was my calling in life.
Absolutely, ma'am. And I think I can place myself in your shoe because even I have a dog, and nobody can love you as unconditionally as an animal does. So I think it's one of the greatest things that you can work for. You are becoming the voice for those who do not really have a voice. So which is something that needs to be a goal for everyone's life, I think. So ma'am, you also talked about animals being slaughtered in performances. And I know for a fact that you've worked to get away with animals being used in religious performances in Uttarakhand. And you've worked a lot towards that. And but ma'am, don't you think that, I just want to ask you, what kind of challenges did you really have to face? Because when there is something in India that gets associated with religion, there is so much to talk around it. And how did you actually get your way through this thing that you've done in Uttarakhand? How were you able to do it? And what were the challenges that you actually went through?
So basically, like any person who believes in God and likes to go, or for some reason likes to go to a public place, which is also a place of religious worship, there should be complete freedom. I was denied this freedom when I once went to a temple in Almora, and they were slaughtering a goat there, a baby goat. And it was so distressing. The sight was so distressing for me that I had to run away from there. And that's when I thought that, this is not normal. I mean, the animal's right is there, but if the law doesn't recognize the animal's right, then the law must recognize my right to be in a place without being, harassed or without going through unpleasant experiences of watching animals die. That was one of the arguments that we took in the High Court. I then approached the High Court. At that time in Uttarakhand, not a single lawyer was willing to appear for me. They said, oh, this is a Sanskriti ka issue and this is the culture of this place, and how can you challenge the culture?
Absolutely.
And this case will get thrown out and you will get thrown out of the court and this and that. So I had to appear for myself without being a lawyer. I presented my case. I had all the arguments, right, from the welfare of animals, the endangerment of young minds, children who watch all this brutality, the environment that gets polluted. There are temples in Uttarakhand where up to 10,000 buffaloes used to get slaughtered in Gangoli Ghat, in Bhukhal. These are these were kul devis of certain regiments of the army. And they used to come and hack away buffaloes and roll them down the cliff, just leave them at the foot of the hill to rot and die. I mean, pollute the environment as well. So that was also one argument we took. After the High Court gave instructions to not have animal sacrifice, religious killing of animals was disallowed, then I had to go from village to village and district to district, temple to temple, you know, enforce, getting the district administrations to enforce the order, to report violations, to hold public meetings, to hold workshops with officers, to, you know, gather village panchayats together and explain it to them that, you know, let's move towards a better society. Let's do something more pretty. Let's do something beautiful rather than this gore in the name of religion. And thankfully, the people of my state are extremely cooperative. There was an initial ridicule and a little, you know, opposition. They even went to court, tried to take injunction against me, tried to throw me out of the state. But finally, they knew that I was a persistent little bug. and happy that at the end of the day, a couple of temples have now started holding blood donation camps instead of animal sacrifice.
That's wonderful.
Blood donation for medical purposes, which is so constructive. But there are also temples that have switched to making dolis for Devi, you know, and having competitions among themselves. And the DM gives the prize to the best doli from the best village. So those kind of things have taken place instead of the dirty, filthy things that they used to do earlier. So I think, you know, transition is nice if you're just persistent. There will be opposition. Like we always hear, there are three stages to any change that you need to make. First, they will laugh at you. They will call you a clown for even hoping that this would happen. And then there would be violent aggression. And then the third stage would be acceptance. So, you know, never give up, never get disheartened. Even when it's an uphill climb, you will get there if you're not giving up.
Absolutely, ma'am. So I think you work like a one-man army towards a cause which was so good, and which was actually the, I think the environment was demanding that. Yeah, animals were demanding that. So I think you work like a one-man army, and congratulations for that.
I can't say that the government didn't help. The Uttarakhand Animal Welfare Board, the animal, in fact, the chief minister of Uttarakhand now, Mr. Trivendra Singh Rawat, at that time, he was the animal husbandry minister. And he gave, you know, his blessings, you know, he did not really come out and say, okay, stop animal sacrifice, but he let me do what I was doing.
Yeah,
I think that was again, I would say, silent support of the government, which was very critical at
absolutely,
this time.
Absolutely.
In states like Tripura, we are struggling, you know, because the government is against ban of animal sacrifice. So we are fighting with the government there. At least in Uttarakhand, I did not have to fight with the government. It was just the people that I had to convince. So I think the fight was much easier. It's different in every state.
Absolutely, so, I think, yeah.
In every state, for every issue, there is a different battleground. It's a different chess set.
Absolutely, ma'am. Absolutely true. Ma'am, I really want to ask you this question of what do you think is one of the biggest problems or biggest difficulties that animals are under today? What is that?
People have largely become insensitive. I think our ancestors, even when they were, you know, keeping animals for food, for wool, for milk, there was a little bit of sensitivity. There wasn't so much production pressure on farm animals, especially. Now, I feel people have become insensitive. There is production pressure. The central and state governments are putting even more production pressure. Everybody is in a rat race of producing, just extracting more and more milk out of buffaloes and cows, more and more meat out of poultry birds, you know, eggs. It's just, we're trait selecting these animals. You're cramming them up in small, you know, straight jacketed places. It's just heinous the way we are rearing these animals. Then the commercial exploitation of cats and dogs and birds in pet shops and breeders' places. It's just, you know, for the little commercial interests that that these people have, and for the fanciful, thoughtless purchases that people make, you know, for, you know, you can easily have something nice and vegetarian for your dinner, but if you Swiggy, you go and buy something without even thinking that you're actually buying a carcass in the name of chicken something.
Absolutely.
You know, you can avoid it and it would have no ill health on your life or your health or nothing, for momentary pleasure. We consume the carcass of an animal that had died a very painful death and an animal that did not want to die.
Exactly.
So I think that's those true. Choices are becoming very, very casual now, very casual. People, instead of adopting the existing animals from shelters, prefer to buy, I don't know. And the weirdest thing is that Indian people don't like Indian dogs. They want you know, some Firangi dog or what. I mean,
absolutely.
They're perhaps just compensating for their own inferiority complexes.
Absolutely.
Because, I mean, somebody who is totally thinking in the right manner and a scientific manner wouldn't know that Indian species are best acclimatized to our climate. They're the ones who fall least sick. They're intelligent, they're beautiful. John Abraham has an Indian dog, for God's sake. So what prevents my neighbor from, you know, keeping an Indian dog rather than going and buying a pug, which is the most unhealthy species and a badly trait selected species that is perpetually ill, poor things. So I think it's just the commercialization of animals for meat, for various other things, is something that is the biggest problem. They're the largest number of animals, you know, get killed in this fashion.
Absolutely, ma'am. I think today we as people in the society, we are commercializing everything. We are commercializing beauty. We are commercializing animals. We are commercializing every part and every sphere of our life. And I think when we are commercializing a being, I think that's the worst thing that we can do. And what you said was absolutely correct, that rather than adopting a dog, we go and buy it for money. And there is another dog who's there, who's waiting for us to be there and take it away. I think what you said makes so, so much sense. Also, ma'am, here, I do not mean to hurt anyone's sentiments, but I really want to ask, and you mentioned it here right now, what do you think about people who are non-vegetarian?
I think two things about them. If they are aware of what they are consuming, I look at them differently, and sometimes people make very informed choices, then I look at them differently. Because I was a non-vegetarian myself till I was about 17, 18 years of age. I used to, in fact, make fun of vegetarian people. So maybe that was my orientation at that time. And I had dogs and stuff in the house, you know, rabbits and various animals who I was casually attentive to, but never as protective as I am now, because that realization had not come in at that time. When I started working for street animals and I realized how badly abused they can be and what dangers they can, you know, be exposed to, that's when I basically also decided to become a vegetarian, because I thought that I cannot care for one species and eat another species, you know. So that would make me a hypocrite. So when the realization came, I had to give up eating meat, eggs, whatever. And then I transitioned to observing dairies and how little calves are exploited, they are starved to death, and their mother's milk is sold away to other people for making their tea. It's like, how important can tea be? Can it be as important for you as much milk is important for a baby? For its own mother's milk, for God's sake. So then I obviously transitioned to becoming a vegan. I don't judge people who don't realize what they're eating. Children or people who've never thought about it, or they've never come to, you know, understand, you know, really, and they, who've never given it a thought. They, I guess, require sensitization. But they're also another variety of people who completely understand it, who have given it a lot of thought, and they continue to eat. Well, those are the villains. Because if you can, you know, give it a thought, and now with social media, I'd say a majority of people absolutely understand that this is a dead animal, and an animal that was killed brutally in a hideous manner. And that no animal wants to die. Forget an animal. Who wants to die? Nobody. It was raised in a dirty, filthy condition. That life and that death, that poor creature did not deserve. But it went through it only because I wanted a pizza with some meat on it. Like, how justified is that? It's just not fair. And a person who knowingly eats meat, I would say would not be a good person in my eyes, because that person wouldn't be fair. If you can't be fair in one situation, you're likely not to be fair in another situation also.
Absolutely.
So you have to be consistent. Exactly. So in my opinion, I would trust such a person much less.
Absolutely, ma'am. I don't think you can love a dog and then go out and eat meat. That is just so hypocritical of you. And you have to be consistent in your thoughts, just as you said. Absolutely true. I absolutely stand with what you're saying. But viewers out there, these are opinions that we hold. It's not essential that you hold the same opinion. Next, ma'am, I really want to ask you, of People for Animals is actually functioning for like 30 years now. So what is that one thing that you haven't been able to solve for animals until today?
It's just people's attitudes. We are growing so much in population. Our needs are growing. Our needs for milk, for meat, for this, that, and the other. There are laws, but then these laws have become so archaic. We are still fighting. Recently, I floated a petition on change.org and put out thousands of appeals to the Prime Minister asking him to amend the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, because it was made in 1960 and the penalty is still 50 rupees. Like 50 rupees is less money than somebody would have to pay to an auto wala to go to court. Like, it's ridiculous. You can buy a bag of chips for 50 rupees. That cannot be termed as penalty at all. We are requesting the Prime Minister to change that. There are so many new avenues that are just opening up to exploit animals. And I believe that's only because people's own little cocoons of lifestyles is not opening up to, they're not opening up their hearts to include the environment, the animals. They're not realizing. Most people are yet to look at situations as, this is just one planet we have. We can either kill other species, destroy the environment, live in a mess, but be happy in our little flat, which is all perfectly fine. We have to look at ourselves as parts of a global family. We're all earthlings. Just because another species, another animal, another creature cannot defend itself doesn't mean that we go out and kill it. We need to nurture not only ourselves, our families, our friends, but also the environment that we live in and the creatures that live in that environment. Only then can we truly be happy. Only then can we truly leave a happier world behind for our children. So we need to change the mindsets, the perspective, and that's what we are trying to do. It's a less now of individual animals, more of, you know, the whole global family of creatures that we are.
Absolutely, ma'am. I think all of us here, in some or the other way, need to learn how to live harmoniously with other creatures or with other people or with other species. Absolutely. And lastly, ma'am, I really want to ask you, of what message do you have for the viewers out there?
My message is very simple. Be tolerant, exercise restraint. If there is a pigeon in your balcony, don't shoo it away. Put a bowl of water out. If there's a dog on your road, give it some food. Don't go out and change the world. Just change the little things around your house. If there's a monkey that comes to your place, fine, avoid it, ignore it. You don't have to get intolerant when it comes to animals, and you can exercise a little bit of restraint, because it would only mean choosing this part of the menu or the other for you. But for some creature, it would mean life or death. So understand the seriousness of the choices you make, and make compassionate choices. It's very simple. It's not going to harm you. In fact, it's going to be better for your health and better for the environment. It's going to be just the more sensible choice. So make compassionate choices be a little tolerant. We have these creatures around us who need us. If you can't be a crusader, at least don't be the villain.
Absolutely. And I really want to thank you for doing the work that you're doing, ma'am. And at some point in my life, when I'm done with my studies, I really want to get with you and do this kind of work, because the kind of satisfaction that you get after doing it, you can't compare it with anything, I think. So thank you so much for doing what you're doing, ma'am. And I'm really glad that I could actually have this conversation with you. I don't think I could have a better evening. Also, I would link ma'am's Instagram or any of the social media handles down in the description. You can get in touch with her in case you want to get associated and do this great work, just like I want to do at some point in my life. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being here. It was so good. So, so good to have you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anjali. God bless you, Bitter. God bless
you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Bye, ma'am.